Hey, you contacted me, what, a couple weeks ago?
Yes.
This is our like fourth session, so our fourth hour after the consult. You found me on YouTube, right? You found me on
Yeah.
YouTube.
Yeah,
So,
I'd watched a whole bunch of your videos for a couple of years, actually.
and then what, and what were your thoughts during that time?
Well, I was struggling with what I thought was just basically an eating disorder. And a lot of things that you were saying in your videos were ringing true in an uncomfortable way. Especially concepts like thin supremacy. And there was just like this freedom that I couldn't really completely relate to, but that was very obvious, had been discovered by the people you were working with. So I don't know, just like over the past couple of years, as my situation didn't really get any better, or actually got worse.
It got worse, yeah.
I've reached basically a point of hopelessness, I would call it. I really didn't know what to do. I felt very like apathetic, like I don't know, life was like not real or not really becoming what I thought it should be. And which is very depressing. So
Well,
that's been
yeah. You know, when I talk in the videos and I'm like, you're suffering. You are totally suffering. It's like
completely
being in a
suffering.
cage that's very dark. You can't see anything outside of it. You desperately want out, but you don't know how to leave, right? Because what you need that space. That space is who you are, whatever. It's like a weird way. It's like feeling paralyzed spiritually, psychologically, emotionally, completely in paralysis, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And the harder you try to get out of it, like the worse it becomes. And I just felt like I was in prison and I couldn't really understand why, you know, even though I didn't want to admit it to myself, but it was a self-created prison.
Yeah, but do you see now that you never really questioned what you were doing? Remember that, yeah, our last session, I was like, look, you have no idea you're doing this, but you're really creating this idea of who you are and what you should be, and that's the problem,
Yeah, I
right?
mean,
And
it
you're
was more
like,
than
but
that.
isn't, aren't I supposed to be working on who I am? Aren't I supposed to want to be a better person? Shouldn't I be working on who, you know? And I'm like, well, no, that's actually what you're taught and sold. But so anyways, our we've had some pretty rough sessions, meaning like it was pretty brutal, right? Like we had some brutal
Yeah,
sessions.
last time, you know, when you called me out on being a narcissist, which was like the hardest thing in the world for me to hear, because I'd always kind of like victimized myself in my mind that, you know, my mother was a narcissist, and I have siblings who are narcissists, and my ex-husband was a narcissist. And to
Everybody's a
absolutely,
narcissist.
and I was always like a victim, you know, and to actually admit that I myself was one as well was excruciatingly uncomfortable. But these past few days, my whole like perception, first of all, of myself, you know, I've been completely understanding and researching and reading about what narcissism is, and it makes sense. I mean, my marriage was like complete sham because we were both narcissists, so we created this like nice little fantasy of
Right,
what
like
life should be.
we're so
And
amazing
I
and we
mean,
have all this potential and I have a gift to give.
we're better than everyone, and we're gonna go out and we're gonna make it, and we're gonna move to like New York City, and look at us. You know, we're living the life and we're living the dream, and we're going on our snowboard vacations and this and that. And at the first sign of crisis, everything, like the first time something went wrong, everything just completely fucking fell apart because it wasn't true, you
Yeah,
know?
well, and
And it
you don't know how to manage, right? You don't know how to manage any of that emotionally. Yeah, well, because you're coming from that underdeveloped, you're not developed emotionally, and that's a big part of people who are, when we say narcissists, what we're saying is inferiority complex, or extremely fearful of inferiority. So it is just a symptom. It isn't, that has been called, you know, a borderline personality disorder, but I think it's, once someone recognizes this, like when I said to you, look, you're fantasizing, because you're like, because I have things to give, right? And you were, you remember, and that was the moment I was like, no, you need to hear that, right? Like, that's your role. But then what I had to do is I had to give you the comparison, right, of what it would feel like to live on a farm away from life. And you were like, oh my God, that would be so relieving, right?
Completely.
That gave you this awareness, like, oh, I'm working so hard in the realities, that's the suffering.
Like, exactly. Like, I'm working so hard because I need validation, because, like, I spent, you know, these past few days actually revisiting, like, when this all started, like, in my childhood, I was never, like, my feelings were not validated. It was not recognized. You know, I was, you know, you're chastised, you're picked on, or you're basically, I mean, almost bullied, I think, in a way by my parents to become something that I wasn't.
So let me give the listener on this video kind of reference. You were raised in pretty much extreme religious ideology.
Yeah.
Where it's your identity. This religion is your history, it's your culture, and it's your identity. Sure. And it never clicked for you. It never really. And they were very strict and very idealistic. Do you see now that that was their way to love and keep you safe? They use,
completely.
Yeah, that's their identity. And they want you to feel, be safe, because that's what they're safe in. I had a similar issue in terms of, like, I know my parents loved me, and what they were doing was really, truly the best they could. And the amount of work that goes into that, right, is pretty astronomical when you think about how hard your parents work to keep you in that environment.
Yeah.
Can you see why it doesn't work for you, why they would, especially if they praise or put what they believe on a pedestal, right? Like, we are the chosen people. We have this love. We are the higher religion of all the religions. We were raised with different religions, but totally exact approach, right?
Yeah.
So they might as well be the same.
So much, I mean, you know, because God's going to judge me, and they don't want me to be evil, and I have to carry on all this history and this tradition. Mm. And to be fair, there's a lot of beauty in that, but the way that they kept it and the way that they tried to use it as a tool to control, because when it came down to it, they didn't really have the emotional capacity to
either.
Actually let me be myself and express myself and become my own person. They saw me. They weren't trying to raise a healthy adult. They were trying to have a baby that was an extension of them, and then another one, and then another one.
Yeah. Well, they were trying to raise a healthy adult. They thought what they were doing was healthy. Similar to what you thought the other day. You thought that was healthy and the right thing to do, and don't we need to become better people? Shouldn't I aspire to do all of this? Sure. And you had to have a moment of clarity, right? Like a moment of sitting back and looking at it with clarity to see the dysfunction in what you were doing to yourself, right? Because you were doing to yourself what your parents did to you. You just removed the word religion and put social programming, right? Some other social pursuit. So, and I did the same thing, right? Can you see now where body image would fit into that? Like, body image became your religion. It became what made you feel safe. So when you look at your parents and the history, even the history in religion, it's like this weird, it is narcissistic, right? Especially when you're trying to feel like I'm not inferior. You're trying to prove your system or your culture through superiority. And you're like, look at us. We have money. We have this, we have that, we're so amazing. I mean, America is one huge narcissistic system.
Sure.
We're the best country on the planet. I mean, that is super narcissism, right?
And it's bullshit, though, it's true. Like, it's not human. It doesn't stem from a genuine place. It's overcompensation.
Yeah, for fear of death. It's a survival mechanism. So you're, yeah, and we talked about those states of survival, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, so you were, we just started the session. You're like, holy shit, Robin, that last session messed me up. I want you to explain that to the listener. Because this was the moment you realized that it was the self-awareness of narcissism, which they say very, it's like impossible for, they never think that they're the problem. Never, ever, ever. And they always, the martyr-victim role, I talked to you about that as well.
Right. I mean, I had to basically take a first of all, I mean, my entire life has been, like, my perspective, I've been revisiting a lot of things that have happened to me, especially in my childhood, and suddenly understanding these coping tools that I developed throughout my life, because I, in my very core, felt like there was something wrong with me. There's something wrong with me because I'm not being seen for what I am. I'm being criticized. I don't fit in. You know, there's something fundamentally wrong with me.
Yeah.
And everything that ensued since then, I mean, this overcompensation, this overimportance and need to feel, you know, like I'm special and and this exhausting chase to perfect your image.
To prove yourself.
Society, yeah, because I am valuable, so I have to look perfect and I have to have this life, you know, and social media is horrible.
Totally. And it's all superficial, right? It's all stuff that you can easily manipulate because it's not coming from an inside space. It's coming from, I got to prove myself in this system. It's a social problem.
Inside, it's all about how I'm seen. It's like constantly chasing for everyone else's approval and everyone else to be like, oh yeah, you're amazing, you know, you're so great, we're so envious of you. Like, that's all it is. It has nothing to do with who I really am, what really makes me happy. I'm completely out of touch with that. I realized that, like, I have no idea what actually makes me happy, like, from a completely, like, organic place.
Yeah, that intrinsic versus extrinsic reward and motivation that we talked about. And I knew, I could tell too, you know, many of the narcissists that I work with, which is almost every single one of you, right? Because the body image coping mechanism, don't you agree? That's like trying to fulfill that sense of, I can accomplish this because it's, I can take all this survival energy and I can put it behind seeking that social value that is shown to me. And it's also done through this health righteous component, right? That my way of eating is cleaner than your way of eating. And we are the most healthy. And the symbolism of health is very much so like we're superhumans that have betterment than other humans. Can you see how this narcissistic coping mechanism for this real survival fear of inferiority, which comes from that third hierarchy of need? Do you remember that? Okay. So are you starting to put the dots together in this? Okay. So you have that need we all have to want to be wanted and liked, but we live in a culture that says for you to be wanted and liked, this is what you need to be. As a woman, you need to have bigger breasts. You need to look adolescent. You never can be big. You need to have order, perfection. You need to be clean, perfect. You need to meet this visible symbol status, right? And if you can't do that, then you need to, you know, there's the religious ideology that you were raised in, right? So you can look at how you were raised and then go, oh, well, my parents, even if they didn't have, you know, a lot of people get confused in their environment, like, well, my parents weren't religious and they weren't rich and they weren't, well, did they have shame in any of that?
It's all shaming. Society.
Yeah.
Parents shame you and then society shames you. And
yeah. So that's the same thing, right? So if you feel ashamed about a social program, that means that you would feel prideful if you meet a social program. So the pride of that is securing this third hierarchy of need through some sense of superiority. And so there is this constant defense mechanism around making sure I am working hard at proving that I am a, you know, an honorable place of society. And I have to be, to some degree, giving something really quite important for me to feel secure. So I can't just be myself and be secure. I have to go above and beyond just to feel acceptable. Not even, like, special. Like, I have to be extra, extra special, human special, to just feel like I'm an acceptable. Because that's my gift to humanity. That's that weird fantasy of being, like, I am special, so I'm going to prove myself. Again, coping mechanism in terms of feeling very, 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 like, I have nothing to give. Nothing based on just, and, or, okay, so the other thing is, or you feel that kindness is not worth, like, really? That's so dumb. Being kind, being easygoing, that doesn't give anybody anything. Like, oh, you're so sweet. Oh, that's weak. That's weakness.
People are looking at you, you know, yeah. Like, in front of company, you can be kind and show how generous you are, you know, and how confident you are. That, you're only kind if it somehow, you know, strengthens this false sense of self.
Yeah, so it's conditional kindness. It's like, absolutely. You can't, so, and oftentimes the narcissistic culture thinks it's all a sign of weakness to be generous and to be giving and to be loving and nurturing. That's weak. Right. So, but if you have tons of money and you're capable of stealing from the poor and giving more to the rich, for somehow the, like, I can do that and not feel bad. That's supposed to be powerful. Right. So this is really common for, people who, now you're in, tell the listener where you're located. You're talking to me. We're talking right now over Skype. You're in
Tel Aviv,
in Israel. And you've been to New York, you've been to the West Coast here in the United States, but don't you agree too, when you come to the United States, there is this pressure as, you know, as a foreigner, if you're going to live here, that you have to meet, you have to prove that you're better than, like, you can perform. You have to be able to meet the top of the class. You have to have some level. A lot of clients who came here when they were children with their parents had a lot of pressure to succeed in this system, which is extremely narcissistic, right? Again, you can't just be a farmer. You have to be a mega millionaire farmer that, you know, you have to have this crazy level of success to integrate.
Yeah.
Right?
And so, like, you're valuable, like, you're part of, you're somehow moving the, you know, society forward, and you're contributing.
Yeah, and that's what you have to do. So the other thing that's a common thing people worship here is work ethic. So if you work and you're willing to sacrifice your psychology, your emotional well-being, because you're working, people praise that.
Absolutely. Right? So that's what destroyed my ex-husband in a way, is this, like, hustle, you know, this exhausting hustle, like, don't sleep, you know, work as much as you can, do whatever it takes, you know, whatever drugs you need, whatever it takes to show how much you're, you know, you can give. And
yeah, so if you're not working, you're useless.
Yeah.
Right? Anyway, so there's a lot of that. And anyway, so we really kind of honed in on this concept of what you were fantasizing. We talked about there's this fantasy that has all of that pleasure, that what you're doing is you're gambling that your life will be happy, just basic happiness, once you have these achievements that are like what Oprah would say, that makes me, like, gag, is defining moments in your life, right? Like, this would be defining. You're seeking a defining moment, right, to just be happy.
Yeah. I mean, you know, and like, as far as the weight went, you know, because I had reached a point where I was, you know, this, like, ideal thinness, and it wasn't even like joy. It was just like relief. And then it was exhausting because you have to stay there, and I was starving, and there's no happiness that actually comes out of achieving. You're not actually achieving anything, you know. You get there and then you're like, I'm still miserable. Like,
yeah, and I have to work harder, and I have paranoia. The paranoia really gets crazy because you're so fearful and shifty eyes around, because people are seeing it. People are giving you, like, oh my God, you're so beautiful. And some people who are anorexics themselves, you become their enemy.
Well, course.
Right. Which you've done to other people. Cares. Like, that skinny bitch, I hate her. You know? Anyway, well, so...
If people no. who are not narcissists, which I've now...
I told you this. I'm like, no. You're going to be surprised at how many people who are really humble out there.
Just don't care. Like, they don't care about all these things that I thought were such... fundamentals of reality that basically everyone lived according to. Of course, everyone's vain and everyone's self-obsessed, and suddenly it's like I can actually look around and see people as like my vision's completely changed the way I see the world and the way I see people.
I'm sorry, I just got kicked off. Say that again. Suddenly, the way you see the world has changed.
Completely changed. You know, you were telling me about how it's projection, how I'm projecting, and it's completely true. Completely. You know, you don't even understand. Like, I'm the one, like, can you hear me?
I can totally hear you.
Like, you know, when you meet someone, the first thing that you look at and take in and people's, you know, you're looking at people's bodies and just judging them by such shallow criteria.
Well, that was your projection, because that's how you were evaluating yourself.
So, and I thought that's how everyone actually evaluates themselves. It's crazy. Like,
that's the narcissism.
Absolutely.
You see that now. It's like, because you think that your beliefs are ideal, right?
Yeah.
My beliefs are ideal. So therefore, I can't believe that that person would do that. I can't believe that they would. What are they thinking? That's the type of thoughts you have in your mind. It's constantly putting people, it's like they're dumb and stupid. And why can't they meet the standard? What's their problem? I know a lot of people like that. There was a lot of that in my, you know, it's kind of like, don't people know? Like, no, they don't, because they don't believe the same things you do. So, no, they don't. And nor do they care the same way you do, right? Because even if they have the same beliefs, not everybody is as strict with the same beliefs, right? So it's not just what do you believe, it's how strict do you believe that? How identified by that belief are you? How graceful are you in those beliefs, right?
Beyond that, now suddenly I can identify narcissists. Like,
I know it.
The varying degrees of narcissism that people have in their personality, it's so transparent, and it's really sad. Like,
yes, because they have no idea. Because they've been brainwashed. Do you see that now? It's a social condition?
Completely.
Yeah.
But you're trapped in your own minds. Like, you can't actually grow. You're not actually enjoying life.
But you're trapped in the system. Yeah, your mind has been wired to function in that system, right? And much of that system, if we take a look at it from a distance, don't you agree? There's a lot of fear of judgment leaving those systems. Like, you have to be okay being judged, shamed, stoned, right? You have to, and you can't be the victim anymore. Like, you had to surrender victimization. That was a big thing that we started our last conversation with. I was like calling victim out. Oh, victim. You would be like, but victim, you know, I had to really be kind of hard on you with that one. Cause you cannot.
Oh my gosh, Robin. Like,
yeah.
I was so angry at you.
I know.
You know?
It was rough.
Why isn't she giving me compassion and telling me that she's so
You mean
sorry?
Enabling and going, oh, you poor fucking eagle, blah, 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 which is what you do to yourself. You do it enough, right? So you got to remember, too, and the listener, I'm not here to keep you where you're at. So that,
right.
So what's coming from your mind is coming from the state of where you're at. So if you want to change or get out of that, should I just comply with where you're at so that you feel safe there? So that you feel safe. So part of what more than likely attracted you to me is the fact that you knew that I was going to go out of your own thoughts. And she's going to tell me what to do. What you weren't expecting is for me to look at what you want to keep and what you like to do and tell you to change that.
Look, I do know that I've been to therapists before several times, and, you know, there was always, like, this ability to kind of manipulate, whether or not it was conscious, to tell them what I wanted to tell them in order for them to say, oh, poor you, and it's okay, and you're just a victim, and don't be so hard on yourself. I didn't need any more of that. Like, I didn't need anyone to basically feed my narcissism, like, mm-hmm. feed the problem. I, you know, you were just very much like, what do you say? Like, do you want to get better? Well, you have to face this nonsense.
I said, this is the crap that you're telling yourself that keeps you where you're at. I said that. Right. And then I also had to tell you multiple times in those first couple of sessions, I don't care about this story. Stop telling it. You're right. telling me the same story. Why that? So, and then you're telling me later that it doesn't matter. So you conflict your own story. This is all symptomatic of someone who is desperately wanting to keep what they're doing, but they also want recovery from what they're doing. And they don't know, right? I've been there before.
Yeah.
I've been there, right? Because this is a very, you know, and I don't think that there's only one type of narcissist. Because a lot of the clients I work with have been victims of narcissism, but conditioned by the system. So it's kind of like when I told you battered wife syndrome or Stockholm syndrome, where the person holds themselves to the system, the abusive system. They internalize it. Once they've internalized the system, they believe the system and they hold themselves to it. So I think narcissism is one of those, it's kind of like psychological buzzwords right now because there is an epidemic of it. And yeah. It's been this way for decades. So this isn't brand new narcissism. This narcissism started after World War II with, you know, the misogyny that came after World War II. The diet industry, capitalism surging. I'm like, all of this came from this desire to stay superior, to keep. The other thing is it also started here in the United States when women had jobs that were men jobs during World War II. And so once the war was over, these men came home and men became very much, you're inferior to this job. Get the hell out of here. Women are to be in the home. So there was a lot of misogynistic narcissism, at least here in the United States during that time. And the body image culture got really big insurance. So there's history around the narcissism that now we have an epidemic of it, and it's manifesting in all of these kind of obsessive compulsive depression, drug abuse. Remember when I told you people who are reaching way outside of their bubble to feel happy with extreme extrinsic motives, especially trying to feel accepted into your community through these far, far reaching goals, they tend to abuse narcotics because the brain needs equilibrium between I'm a piece of shit and I'm going to change the world. How do you get between this and this when to get here, it takes 5 college degrees and the beautiful mansion with the gorgeous cars and the 5 kids or 2 kids that are perfectly dressed and perfectly behaved. I mean, it gets further and further out. So to live and to create brain equilibrium, we're wired to seek pleasure. And so it's all fantasy pleasure, right? So you live in reality, you live on this planet, you live in the body you have, but all of it feels foreign and not okay, right? That fight or flight stress.
But also, yeah. You know, if you weren't validated as a child, you know, you never actually feel like you deserve any of these things, or you don't even really know who you are. I mean, it's like
there's never really gratification in it because it's not your gratification anyways.
You're
conditioned to gratify others. Yeah.
You created like a fake identity that you think is going to be socially acceptable,
mm-hmm.
and
mm-hmm.
it's just you're just spending your whole life. I mean, basically, I felt like, you know, I was always like in a body of water. And I had to be, you know, like doggy paddling frantically just to stay above because
your body would sink.
I would drown this whole facade, this whole persona, everything I aspired to, the way I thought I should be, you know, whether it was the way I was raised or something drastically different that I was trying to be, you know, tell myself I was part of, basically always trying to tell myself I'm worthy, I'm valuable, you know, and it was exhausting just to stay alive. And it's like these past few days, I was like, you know what, like, I just kind of like stopped moving. I stopped this doggy paddling, and suddenly I realized, like, I'm not going to drown.
Yeah, that's like the, that's how it feels. But you realize in order for you to stop paddling, you had to have gone through this feeling of you're going to die. If you stop, but you were like, but if I keep on doing this, I can't live this way anymore. So there is that decision that every client of mine has and comes to. And if you've watched my YouTube, you've heard me tell someone else this. You either continue to suffer running from that pain of I'm going to die. It's scary. I can't handle it. I have to prove, I have to fix it, right? I have to run from it. I have to organize it. You're suffering managing how to avoid and escape this pain, right? The pain is, as you now know, it feels like death. It feels like you're not going to survive. You are inferior, right? That's that deathly fear of inferiority. And you're going to be abandoned, rejected, disproved of. You're going to be a failure. You're not going to survive on your own. No one's going to love you. You're going to be single the rest of your life. You're going to be living off of the streets. There's all of these irrational emotions that you're running away from that, you know, and then there's also the emotions of like, but I'm embarrassed that I'm not this holy queen of the world that's going to be like Einstein level of and Mother Teresa levels of, you know, specialness, right?
Right.
All of a sudden, it's like, but I am now embarrassed. There's an embarrassment around this on the pain side, right? So you got to the point where you're like, either I keep on doing what I'm doing, or for the first time in my life, I just sit here and let myself fail.
Exactly. You know, it's so weird because it's almost like,
which feels like death.
It's almost like you know, we're trying to fill this role, like a movie role, you know, like a character, and we feel like, oh, if we get the costume right, and the line, the delivery right, and the body right, and the makeup right, then we're going to be happy. Even something, if it's like, oh, my goal is to be, like, you know, an altruist, and you still have this, like, image. It's not coming from a genuine place. It's like this
coming from survival.
To take on this character that you're trying to play. It's not really you, and it's exhausting because you're not living. You're not living. You're constantly chasing an idea of what you think life should be. And the irony is,
and it's abusive. The chase is abusive. When you think about that word, it's like you're chasing this, and you're abusing yourself and others.
You can never get there. Yeah. And at the same time, what you're subconsciously or consciously telling yourself is that what you are and as you are is not good enough, and
you can't handle it.
You're working to be deserving of something else, which is not the way life is.
No. So what we talked about when we at the end of the session, I said, well, you've got to be okay with the remember when I said the antidote to this whole situation is humility. You've got to have the humility. That is the antidote, and that's an emotion you've probably never experienced before, right? No, narcissists, like, what's they don't know what that feeling is. That the neuropeptides in the brain of what humble is, they don't experience because their response to feeling like I'm failing, I lost, is to defend themselves, to blame other people, to position themselves, to blame. Remember, that's the victim positionality. It's their fault. They did it to me. I didn't get what I deserved, and I lost because of this. So you end up never having humility. So I said to you multiple times in that last session, this is going to take some humility. If you really want the recovery you paid me to help you get, right? I'm not going to give it to you, but if you want this, you need to have humility. Stop pretending that you are special and go into the reality of how weak you feel. That weakness is all you have that's true. And if that's all you have that's true, isn't that good enough?
Right. Robin, it set me free because when I went the next couple days and I was walking around and just looking at everyone, and I'm like, yeah, I'm just like everyone else. Like,
and it's the best feeling ever. You know? It's like true love.
It was like, I can, like, it's okay. Like, there's no, you know, it's crazy because all these, this new agey spiritual stuff, and let's go and let's meditate and be present and be in the moment. And even that is like me. And this was suddenly like, I don't need to worry about anything. I don't need to worry about the future. I don't need to try and control anything. I don't need to think about just live. And that's it. Be.
And you, we talked about living from the heart. Like, it's as simple as, what's your favorite color? Doesn't mean it's better than someone's, or it's worse than someone's, or it's not the right one. Just come, what's in the heart, and just, that's the truth. That's what you're living by now.
Just let yourself be yourself. Like,
yeah, and it can be inferior. Remember we talked to about...
That's okay, yeah.
I was very, very much so, what if it sucks? What if it is inferior? What if, because we have to go into that fear... Right? That if it is inferior, you have to have the humility to say, I'm okay with that. I'm okay. I can admit that I am potentially inferior to a lot of things. So why pretend that I'm not when the reality is right now? You know, I remember you saying, I should be, you know, volunteering with all these kids and making an impact. And I'm like, well, you're nowhere close to that, right? Because your integrity is not there. So you're inferior to that role.
Completely.
And isn't that a wonderful thing to admit?
Yes.
That doesn't mean you're a bad person. It just means that you may want to do that, but you've got to got to do it for yourself first to then project that out. You have to be gracious to yourself. Yeah. Volunteer for yourself.
It's because, like, I hold myself to this fantasy standard. And it's not even like you're just, it's kind of like force life to be a certain way and reality to be a certain way and not actually living or just enjoying yourself. You're never enjoying yourself.
So I want you to describe the symptoms. Imagine I'm a doctor and you have all these symptoms. I want you to describe the symptoms you had before that last session. And actually, I remember you saying that you've made quite a bit of progress over the year watching my YouTube videos. But you still had like anxiety. I guarantee it. So describe the symptoms you had before and describe the symptoms you have now. So compare the difference between before humility and then after humility, and grace. Before humility and grace, and then after humility and grace, and how that has impacted your overall state of being. Okay? So describe your state of being before.
I was, like, always under tension. Incredible self-judgments constantly. I mean...
Shame?
You know, just constant need to control everything.
Did you did you feel ashamed of yourself?
Oh, absolutely. Always. You're always ashamed, and you're always judging, and you're always, like, rating yourself, you know, on a daily... I mean, you know, that's like food is so, did I have a good food day or bad food? That can take over your life, that took over my life.
Do you feel like all of that control? Do you feel like all of the control and management and what we would call perfectionism and all or nothingism, do you think that was really the effort you were making to try to not feel ashamed?
Completely, yeah.
So it's understandable. You see that now, like, oh... Yeah. That is so understandable.
You know, because I felt like I was, like, just, like, a piece of shit. Like, I was, like, not worth anything. You know, I'm such a low human, and I can't accept that. I can't let that happen.
Do you see now that that was relative to your grandiose sense of who you are in fantasy? That relative to the fantasy, you really do suck, right?
Course.
Now, that's where the shame comes from, is that there's these standards and elevated sense of what you're supposed to be, and that you're not there, right?
Completely. I mean, that's why, like, at the height of my eating disorder, it's like this point where your mind is telling you, I would rather die than be fat. I would rather die than be fat.
Yes.
Because psychologically, that's almost too much for your mind to bear with, that you would be overweight and that's not attractive. I mean,
a failure, a loser. Die. Yes, that I felt the same way, and I actually chose to die. And in that process of dying, I came to this awareness. Right?
Yeah.
So, because I realized that, what am I really afraid of? Because it really isn't the fat, it's what the fat symbolizes in my self-concept relative to the position I'm playing in society, which is superior in my beautiful body and this fact that I have. I only have this. I don't have anything else to give. So if this is all I have, then if I don't have it, then I am a part of the lowest levels of human that I believe everybody is, right? Then I am inferior. I am. And I had to ultimately look at which one would I rather in reality. So if the truth, if I want freedom, I have to be okay with my reality, which feels inadequate. That's like the swimming and I have to stop and let myself drown, right? Some people feel like they're fighting, like it's war. They have armor and they have all this weaponry, and it's there. Everybody's dying. Everybody's drinking the Kool-Aid, and you know, in terms of like they're so prideful in the fact that we're the best that they're not willing to surrender. If they would surrender, their likelihood of survival goes up. Right. So you got to the point where you were pretty far down there in terms of your shame, which is the lowest state of consciousness, to where you really had nowhere to go.
No.
So the only way to really start over, we talked about that, like you're going to start over, right? You have to.
It was this battle that you're describing, like it's all in your head.
Yeah, but it feels real because your brain has, it believes it's real because it doesn't know you're not credible. It doesn't know we're in a first world environment. It actually has evolved over thousands of years in a third world environment. So it's responding as if it's real, as if you are going to get shunned, as if you are going to wander in the wilderness, as if you are going to die of starvation because no one will feed you because you're a piece of crap, right? As if you don't have ability, as if you don't have all of this. And the reality is, the comparison is about, should you have to suffer to this degree, which is worthy of death, just to feel like you are good enough in your own heart, right? To where it's like, and I realized that no one should ever have to do this to this degree, and neither should I. So if I stop what I'm doing, I have to be okay with the vulnerability of being too weak, being inadequate, being dumb, being all the things that I didn't want to feel, but felt inside. But I had to. And the other thing, if you recall, I said to you, it's going to feel permanent, like permanent weakness, permanent dumb, permanent inadequacy. And I said, but what would you rather? The permanence of the suffering that you have to do and that to get away from those feelings or those feelings. You know, this one requires a ton of work. This one requires humility, right?
And humility is like a blessing.
I know.
Like, I feel I've just been like holding on as tight as I could my whole life. I had to keep holding on, and suddenly, like I just like let go, and I realized like I'm not gonna fall. Like there's nowhere, like I can just like live. Life doesn't.
Yeah.
Life's not a battle.
No.
Life does not have to be a battle to constantly prove to myself that I'm worth something, you know?
Yeah. So tell me the symptoms now. So before it was obsessive compulsive, all or nothing, tons of control, mostly shame, constantly fighting and working. Your mind was working intensely, right? There's a lot of work going on, a lot of management before.
Yeah.
A lot of scratching at the surface, just trying to figure out a way out. So now how do you feel? So what you're describing now, that's why I said, okay, go to the after. After this humility and letting go, truly, and in order to do that, you had to be okay with inferiority. It's not, yeah. I'm going to let go and hope I'm not inferior. It is, no, I'm letting go and I'm accepting that I am inferior. Right?
But it feels so good. Like, it feels good.
I know.
Like,
I described being willing to be killed. The willingness. Yeah. Remember, I think I described that to you. Yeah. I had a couple of these conversations that day where I'm like, it feels like you took your armor off, you set down all your weaponry, you're naked and vulnerable, and you're done.
Yeah.
So whatever you've been running away from that you felt is going to kill you, you are now willing for it to kill you. And it feels permanent. Because that's how the brain's wired to evolve. I mean, death is permanent. So you're running from this feeling of death, which is coming from that ancient survival part of the brain that has evolved over thousands of years. And you are now surrendering to it. And then what's happened?
Nothing.
Well, that's the crazy thing is you're like, oh my God, that was an illusion. That is the most amazing part. I mean, your heart beats, do you recall, like you can't breathe? Your heart's beating, you start to sweat, and you just lay there. I cried. I remember laying there and just crying, right? Just so sad. I was very sad, and I went through, and that was when I had this experience that I have a hard time explaining, but you're living, I guided you kind of the way I was guided in that situation, in my head.
Yeah.
But on the other side of it is this grace.
Because
like, I can breathe, and there's room for me.
Yeah.
And I can fail, right? Remember? I can fail. I can fail at all of this.
I revisited, like, I went back to that point. When I was such a, like, a really young child, like, I remember the first time, you know, the first times in my life, the first points where I was, you know, taught, basically, and acknowledged, like, that I do need to be ashamed of myself. It's all shame. Like, I am flawed, and I need to be shameful, and
you need this religion to be not ashamed.
I need to create this total suit of armor in order to not feel hurt, like in order to not, you know, feel. Basically.
And the armor is, I have to be smart, I have to be beautiful, I have to be rich, I have to have the nice house, we have to have this, you're using social programming, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, that's the thing, it's a social program, it's not you. And so you just
constantly evaluating yourself against this programming.
How do you feel? Describe how you feel. I want you to describe the symptoms of where you're at right now.
I just feel like totally humbled, but it's a sense of relief and. I don't know, I would call it like a joy, like a genuine joy. Like I'm okay, you know? I'm okay just being normal, just not, you know, just
would you say it's like being on drugs without the drugs?
I mean
maybe not as high, but it is a sense of like grace, relief. It's like being high.
Complete release, exactly. Like I'm just kind of flowing now in a different reality, but like in the real world.
So
like,
nothing has changed physically, but everything has changed for you in terms of emotionally.
100%. Your
like totally different perspective on people, systems.
I'm not judging anyone anymore. That's like really what's crazy is like when I'm. Is looking at other people and not judging them, and suddenly also realize that like everyone has like their scars and their baggage, like that's all you know. You can see
we're all pretty much the same,
and it creates so much compassion, like for other people also. Like,
did you know what that word meant before? I mean, did you ever have a true sense of compassion before?
It was
pity. Yeah, it was pity.
It was condescending, like,
oh poor you know, them.
Poor you.
Yeah, that's pity.
You're less than me. You don't understand.
I feel sorry for you. That's what you were doing to yourself, right?
Completely. It wasn't compassion. It was being condescending. That that was like, that, you know.
Bad things happen to bad people. My y'all. Yeah, it's the total shift. You know, when you look at where you were at, the space that you were at, you know, how can you have these feelings of compassion and grace and really self-love? You realize that you actually are loving yourself, and it's not in a superior way. It's not in an egocentric way or an arrogant way, is it? It's really
Robin, that's like the most beautiful thing is suddenly what self-love really, I don't need to earn love. Love is not something to be earned. Love is just like actually being present in this moment and not finding any faults or any flaws within myself. It's just, I am what I am, completely accept it, and that's awesome. Like, that's beautiful. You know, that's what it, love is not an emotion. It's just kind of like the state of completely being serene and at peace.
And gracious, and everything is as it is.
It's insane.
As it should be. It is a totally different level of consciousness. So same body.
I'm not judging reality. And I'm saying, well, things need to be this way. And it's all, like, forget the fantasy of myself, the fantasy of, like, how the world should work. Like, it's all... It's crazy.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you. Are you joking? It's all... You completely, I mean, it's like you popped this whole, like, illusion, this whole veil. I really feel like I was living in this veil in my mind, and you just totally like just words, just an hour, and it all blew away, and there's no return. You can't go back. When you were telling me, I was like questioning you, like I don't know if you remember.
Yes, the whole last part of that, and I knew what you were doing, and I wanted to make sure that I did it for you, because you were like, what does it feel like? How do you do this? How do you do that? And you know where my answers came from?
Truth.
Like, I'm not gonna play I don't play that game. I could. I've done it before. I understand that level, but why would you do that to yourself when it comes with all of this arrogance and ego and separation between you and others? And why would I play that game? I am not better than any other human on this planet. To think that is suffering.
Exactly. Like you said, like, you would have to, like, undergo brain damage to go back there, because it's not just, like, a school of thought. It's
an awareness.
It's a delusion.
Yeah, you become aware. It's like, you think the room looks like this. I heard a description of a, there's this woman who was on like a Dr. Oz or something. I've posted it on my Facebook, but she had a near death experience or a death experience and then came back alive. She was whatever, but she explained this level of consciousness, what it feels like. And her description I think is the best. And I'll describe it here and then we'll stop recording. But her description was that it's almost like you go through life in this dark space with a flashlight, and you're looking at life through a flashlight. So all you see is what the light is flashing on. And what happened to her is all of a sudden the lights in the whole space turned on, so she could see this infinite space of existence that before all she saw what was existing was what the light was flashing on from the light, like the flashlight. So as soon as all of the lights went on and she could see this infinite space of existence, even if the big lights turned off and she came back to the life where it feels like it's only a flashlight, she knew that it was, that flashlight was insufficient to actually show you how great and grand space really is.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? That's how I feel. I'm like, that out of body I had in my new, I didn't die, but I was in the reconciliation process of dying. I had that awareness. And I can't go back.
No.
I would have to go on, I would have to somehow get some type of brain damage to revert me back into only mammal thinking, like that survival mammal brain. That would have to be the only thing existing for me to go back.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
But 100%. But even more so, it's like suddenly life itself is like amazing because.
Mm-hmm. Do you need a narcotic now?
No, beforehand I thought it was so, like, defined, and it's like everything's upside down, and suddenly you realize it's, like, endless, it's boundless. Your consciousness and awareness of different levels of just, like, people, and it's amazing. Like, there's so much more to take in and appreciate. I was, like, restricting my vision of reality.
What to finish this video, what was it that really made that the shift for you?
Like just admitting to myself that I was living in a fantasy.
When you became aware that what I was describing was real.
Yeah, as much as I hated it,
yes.
You know, for threatening my identity, or yeah. What I thought was my identity, my false identity.
Yeah, it's like ripping off what makes you feel comfortable. And there was probably a lot of cognitive dissonance, even though you were aware that it was really true. You had a little humility in that moment to be able to admit it.
Well, only because I knew that what I was doing wasn't working. You know, because as much as I was defensive, at the same time, I was in so much pain. Mm-hmm. And I knew what I was doing was not working.
In that moment, you had to stop blaming because it hasn't been working, but you've always blamed and said it's the circumstance. It was because of him. It's because of my parents. It's because of the religion. So you're constantly blaming. So in the moment, for some reason, it may have been that how I said, you're playing the victim role, playing the victim role. That's a victim role. Like, stop blaming and now look at it. Right. So I don't know.
Yeah. No, you're right. I realized I was constantly deflecting all of the responsibility onto someone else.
Or something else, like environmental, religious. Exactly. Yeah.
And so what? So it's everyone else's fault. So what, does that make my situation any better? No.
I know. Some people deflect it onto me. Some of the people I work with, they think I'm the problem next.
Right.
Can you see how that would happen? Remember when you just told me, like, you were pissed. And I'm just like, you want to recover? Pissed. You need to hear this, right? You paid me a lot of money to be brutally honest with you about what this is going to take.
Yeah.
So I did it.
I mean, you did. You killed the facade. Like, you killed it for me. Like, it's dead. It's crazy. And it was so hard.
It's like suicide.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like suicide of the false and the exposure of the real. It's like coming out of the closet.
Yeah, but you gave me my, like, give me my life back. I don't know if I can say that because I don't know if I was ever actually alive.
I love what you just said. I do believe people live suspended outside of their bodies until they don't. And you just entered your body and you're alive. Your life just began. It's amazing. Although we can say that everything that happened up to this moment was preparatory, which is essential. You had to suffer to know what this is. The suffering that you had before is it is necessary to know that this is bliss. This is bliss.
The gratitude that I feel for this is insane. Like, insane, because it was like being in prison for 31 years, and like suddenly, I mean, I don't feel like there's no sense of like poor me at all anymore. It's been quite the opposite. It's like, oh my God, like I can actually start living now. I didn't even know this existed. Like, I had no idea what life was. I had no idea how to live or what reality was. It's crazy.
I totally understand. You have me crying over here.
Robin, thank you so much. Thank you.
I know how you suffered, and I am so grateful that you have the humility to let me help you. It's like I relive it through you. And I am so grateful for whatever did it for me. So, I'm just so happy for you. So, welcome to life.
You're so cute. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Well, it's amazing, right? When it's like, oh my God, you should almost feel like you just, same body, but and same soul and same life, but it's been like completely renewed and you have the wisdom. So that didn't go away. Right?
No, the wisdom makes it better. Like,
I know. That's why I said that suffering is essential to getting to this place.
Completely.
No. The willingness to die.
Yeah.
The willingness to die is huge. Because all of a sudden that mammal part of the brain that is run from death, that is no longer going to affect you the same way. Ever.
Ever. And like, ever. You just want to absorb every moment. Yeah. Like, I just want to take in everything, like, slowly and relax. And it's amazing. It's fucking amazing.
We still have like 6 sessions left. What are we going to talk about? No, I'm kidding. There's work to be done, but that right there is the most important step in recovery.
Yeah.
Well, all of it's important. I hate to say that because like you look back and you're like, oh, each little thing played a very important part.
Not like this. So,
this was what some people would call your awakening, where you finally woke up. But the torture that you went through ahead of time was required. So each part of your suffering, every time you were egotistical, every time you were super prideful, every time you pushed people below you, each one of those moments were essential to this, to what we've gone through. You had to have done all of that to have all the shitty ass karma come back for you to unravel all of it.
Yeah. This was a paradigm shift. It really is like suddenly like, oh my God, the world is round. Like that's the, I can't even imagine. It's crazy.
Do you have anything you want to say to the listener before I end this video?
Life is not suffering, and if you're suffering, you're not living. Like, and if I mean, anyone can do it. Like, anyone can get out of it. And you're Robin. You're amazing. I mean,
really, I'm not. See, this is. Remember when I told you once you go through this, you're gonna get to this other place that I can't describe. I can't even tell you this exists. I can just say what you're doing sucks. Just go into a place you don't know. And I remember saying to you, and when you get here, I said, when you get here, you're going to look at me and go, oh, Robin's not all that smart. There's all this knowledge here. There's all this awareness.
Yeah, but your ability to communicate with me in a way where I understood is, I mean, like, you know, no matter how much self-help or, like I said, other therapists and other throughout my life, it's crazy. Since I was a teenager, I went to so many forms of treatment, and I spoke like 3 times. You're just your understanding and your ability to communicate, because you didn't have it. You know, you're not doing it for you or for your ego or to be like, oh, look at me and I'm right and I'm so smart. It really is like it was so just so genuine. And I think that. You just completely changed my life. Like, it's crazy. I'm so grateful. You don't even understand.
No, I do. I'm telling you, I do. I do, but I'm telling you, you did it. I didn't do anything. I just basically said, look at this, look at that, You might want to admit this and admit that. Now look at this. Now look. How are you going to change it? And you're the one that did it. I didn't even walk you through the death process. You had to do that on your own because we didn't do it on the phone. Yeah. Sometimes I do it with people on the phone. But you didn't do that with me. You were positioned there and you instinctively did it on your own. That I stopped swimming. That moment I did not do on the phone with you.
No.
You did that. That right there. You did that. And that's what you have to do, right? I didn't do that. I did it for me. But I when you look back at this in your life at different times and you have more clarity and you're like, how did that happen? What happened? How did this work? I still am confused. I still don't know how that conversation worked, but it did.
Yeah.
And all it did was prepare you to do, to stop swimming, right? To stop.
Sure.
But you did that.
I'm grateful that the universe, like, presented you at the right time, at the right place, whatever it is.
Well, you were ready. You had to have been suffering. People don't come to me unless they really, really are suffering. So there was that attraction too. Like, you at some point said, I have to talk to her. And I know she's not going to tell me everything I want to hear.
I guess I didn't have the balls, you know, for like a couple years.
You weren't ready. You probably could go back and go, oh, I wouldn't have even done it.
Right.
She would have said, do this, and I wouldn't have done it. So it would have been a waste of money.
Yeah.
Right. So it had to have been like, I'm ready to do it. It's that bad. Yeah. All right. Thanks for letting me share this.
Of course.
The best quote I've ever heard.